Hello and welcome to part 5 of creating trendy neon 80s graphics with me, Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. And this is the final part of the series. So what our main focus is going to be on is putting everything together. So we're going to take our text, our graphics, make any sort of small changes that we need to. Then I'm going to show you a couple of little tricks that I like to use to tie the whole world together so that we end up with something that looks a little bit like this. This is our starting point for part 5, where we left off in part 4. So now we've got the main shape of the project. I want to animate up some of the elements so we get a bit better transition to bring all this stuff in. So I'm going to turn off my floor again for the moment to get this rendering a bit faster, and turn off the big beautiful glow as well. And I'll also turn off dreams because I want to focus just on the neon coming through, the neon text. And I'm even going to turn off the fill because we're going to just animate up the outlines first. Now in this project, because it's, you know, slightly over the top, we want big, bold transitions. So the transitions that we're looking at aren't, you know, nice, happy, dissolved transitions. Oh, just coming in, looking all very nice. Yeah, we don't want any of that. We want sort of something that's a little bit harder. We want wipes and we want warps. And I think we're just going to start off with a general wipe. So I'm going to come down to the Sapphire transitions, and we have a large number to look through. But most of these break down into either wipes of some sort, dissolves of some sort, or the bits in the middle, things like flutter cut and film roll. So some sort of push usually. But we're only interested in one of these, and it's going to be wipe flux. And what wipe flux does is it just animates this on with organic looking shapes. Let's make our frequency higher, turn our frequency up so that we get some smaller shapes coming in. Yeah, around about there, that's looking kind of cool, like that. Maybe add a little bit of softness to the edge, not a lot. Maybe just 1 point. Then we can just sort of animate this on as we need to. So I'm going to take my wipe percentage to 100% so we can't see it. Animate that on maybe over about a second or something. Maybe a bit too fast. Let's hit U and take it over maybe a second and a half, maybe 2 seconds actually. Because it's mainly filled in after about a second and a half. Yeah, that's cool. Good. All right, so the next bit is to come in and add a bit of warp to it now. Now, this is a companion to one we saw a couple of exercises back. We looked at distort chroma. We're going to look at warp chroma now. And warp chroma works in a rather similar sort of way. We define the to and from points. There we go. And it's going to create a number of steps, which we define up here. We'll do 20 steps. We get 20 steps walking through there. Okay, we don't want 20 steps. We only want 8 steps. And I'm going to leave pretty much everything else set to default. And the only thing I'm going to change is the from distance over about maybe a second and a half. Let's try that. So I'm going to set my keyframe. So my from distance is at 1, come to the beginning and take that down all the way down to 0, or as close to 0 as I can get, 0.001. And let's just RAM preview that. Cool. Let's hit U one more time to show us our new keyframes. Not the embossed glass or the warp, but the flux and the warp chroma. I'm going to make these a little bit faster to come in. Let's see what we've got there. Very nice. What I'm also going to do in the warp chroma is we have a ability to bring our brightness up a little bit. So I'm going to crack the brightness up quite a lot. Actually, around about, 5.5, 6 almost. And then as it comes in, I'll bring the brightness back down to 1 again. Just so that when we start hitting it right at the very beginning, we have a real sort of strong smack of color, smack of brightness before it comes in. Oh yeah, loving that. A very colorful 80s Tron there, which means like Tron, but even better because it's colorful. All right. And the last thing to do is maybe just even add another wipe over the top of this. So we can really start to see what the wipes are doing. And I'm going to go wipe circle. And I'm not going to do anything clever at all with this. The only thing I'm going to do is bring the center up a little bit at about 400 and then simply keyframe this in over 4 seconds. So from 100% to 0%, and let's see what we've got. Yeah, cool. And I'm going to soften that edge out a lot. About 300 pixels. Really smoothly draw that in. Yeah, I think I like that a lot. Okay, good. So now let's add in some of this fill. So when we've got it around about here, maybe around about 2 seconds in, I'm going to bring our fill in as well. So let's recycle some of the stuff we've already got. So I'm going to take the wipe flux and just copy that and paste that over the top of my fill. And that should paste in the keyframes as well. If I hit U, we can see the wipe flux has taken in those keyframes there. So it's going to keyframe that in over about a second. Cool. And let's do the same sort of thing then, about 2 seconds in, to our dreams as well. And this time, I think I'm just going to take the warp chroma and the wipe circle, copy those, and paste those onto my dream layer. And let's have a preview of that, see what that looks like. Okay, yeah, I think we need to change the timings up a little bit and change the order of the effect up a little bit here, especially with the dreams. The glow needs to come down underneath everything else. Definitely, yep. And we'll make everything just a lot faster, just come in a lot faster. So I'll quickly do that. We'll start with the outlines. That comes in over about half a second. The fill is here, and that will come in almost immediately afterwards. And then all the other stuff with the dreams will come in a lot faster as well. And that wipe circle, I can bring that in a bit slower, but still faster than it was before. So let's round preview that, see how that looks. Yeah, and that's working better. I have obviously messed up one of the keyframes here. Probably I've grabbed a position keyframe that I should not have grabbed. Yes, it's exactly what I've done. Let's link those back up together again, shall we? And that's looking good. Right, perfect. Let's move on and start having a look at the floor background again, the animated floor background, and see how we can bring this in. So I'm going to add another wipe to this, and it's going to be transition wipe rectangle. Let's turn the other effects off for a second just so that it renders a little bit faster. And what the wipe rectangle does is it wipes it in like a rectangle. Strange that. So let's animate this in over a second and a half, maybe. Bring that in. That's looking good. Maybe over just more like 3 seconds. Yeah, that's going to be fine. That's the right sort of speed that I'm after. Now, one thing we can do with our wipes in Sapphire is add borders to them. So I've got two ways of doing this. I can add just like a regular hard border, like that. Nice. Or, let's take that back to zero. Or I can add a border glow instead. And let's just glow this up. Let's change our glow color. And we'll have a nice blue glow. Something around about there. Nice fat width, around about 35. Leave everything else at default. And let's take a look how that works in context. Turn the proxy resolution down a little bit so we can get a faster RAM preview. We'll see how this starts to work. Yeah, and that's kind of cool. probably do want it to come in a bit faster. I'm going to have it finishing around about here, about 2 seconds in, and that should make a much nicer pace for us. Yeah, that's cool. That's cool. Turn our other effects and turn us back up to full res. And we are almost done here. So all that's left for us to do is start to glow everything up a little bit more. Now I'm going to do a, let's add in the sun. Now I'm just going to cheat a little bit just to try and tie in everything in the background. I'm going to make a sort of glow that's not actually a glow. I'm going to create a new adjustment layer and I'm going to add a blur. So Sapphire blur, looking good. And all I'm going to do is on the adjustment layer, change that blend mode to add. Now I can crank up that glow. And that sort of blends everything together a little bit. Obviously, I can choose whether to have it including the sun or not just by changing the layer order. I think I'm going to have it without including the sun, because when I turn on my final big, beautiful glow, the one that we've been using all the way through, that might just sort of overwhelm it a little bit. Just rename that my blur layer. And it might be a little bit too much on the glow. So what I might do is just take that back down a little bit, maybe to 50%. Or another thing I can do instead is come in and add a curves over the top. And either bring the whole thing down there or come into my individual color channels and maybe add a touch more purple in here. So add a little bit of red, a little bit of blue. And yeah, I think I'll even bring the gamma down there just a little bit. Do a final tweak up on the curves on the blur layer. Yeah, then all that's really left for us to do is kind of have one more thing just to tie everything together and sort of mess it up, just dirty it up maybe just a little bit more. So I'm going to apply an adjustment layer over the top of everything. And I'm going to apply a film effect. Turn off my title safe. And so I'm going to go to Sapphire, film effect. And that's going to change everything completely. Now with film effects, we've got a few things we can change. We can change the negative print, where we're starting from, and the positive print, print film there, where we're going to. And that will have a big, you know, effect on what we see here. But the probably the most important one that we can use is this scale CC. So this is how much of the effect we're going to be using. So 0, we've got nothing. 1, we've got everything. Now I use film effect a lot, but a lot of the time you wouldn't notice it. Because I like to think of film effect as the seasoning rather than the main taste. Because it's like you put a pinch of salt on your food and everything tastes better. You put a shaker of salt on your food and you can't taste anything else apart from salt. And that's exactly the same as the film effect here. We put a little bit on it, it looks cool. We put a lot on it and it sort of just ruins everything. And then we can either, you know, add in some grain as well. Tons of grain, noise, no. Stick a vignette over the top as well. And to sort of do the final little tweaks as we need to. So that's cool. And if we're hitting too much of something like the sun there, I told you there's a reason that I want to keep all of this stuff really easily available to us. You know, way back in exercise 3, I think part 3. So that all I have to do if I want to take it down the hot spot in the middle there is just literally click on this inner color and then it's done. All right, so I think all that's left for us to do now is hit this RAM preview and then wait a little bit and then come back and see what our final shot looks like. I think we've done what we tried to set out to do right at the beginning of this. We made a nice, big, trendy, neon 80s graphic. You know, it's bright, it's glowy, it's fun. Doesn't take itself too seriously at all. I like this. So what we focused on in part 5 is actually the transitions. So bringing on the text and the graphics in an interesting sort of way that fits in with the style of the rest of the piece. And I think, you know, barring a couple of timing changes we could possibly make, I think we've been fairly successful with that. I especially like the Tron-style wipe of the grid at the start with a nice glowing border that we haven't used before in any of our other transitions. I'm actually going to leave this series here. I think we've done quite a lot over the course of, you know, probably, you know, about an hour. And I hope you found at least a few techniques you want to experiment with or borrow as your own, just, you know, straight from whole cloth. If you want to have a look at this project, then it's available to download at the link in the description below. So don't forget to do that. And that project doesn't just have the one that we've made together here. It also has my inspiration project, my final project that I was working on before. And you might see a few differences between those two, because of course, as you're working, and this is a very creative kind of job, things are going to hit you differently, or you tweak a particular parameter in a way that you didn't do before, and you sort of like, go, oh yeah, no, I really like that. And I like to think that's one of the things that Sapphire prompts, is it prompts you to sort of just play around a little bit with the parameters and seeing how playing with one value or combining a couple of different effects together can give you something that's either very different or greater than the individual parts that you put into it. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. Thanks very much for joining me in this series, Trendy Neon 80s Graphics, and I'll undoubtedly see you again soon. Thanks a lot for now. If you've enjoyed this series, then remember to hit the like button and subscribe to our YouTube channel to be first in line for all the new tutorials as they come out. If you have any questions or comments, then you know where to leave those in the comment section below. To get your copy of Sapphire, then head over to borisfx.com, where you'll find details about all Sapphire filters and other Boris FX products.